If you want to make some easy and fast money in Star Citizen, then stay tuned, because today I'm going to give you the ultimate guide to Quantinium mining. And we're going to go over everything, the ships, the equipment, where to go, what to do, what to look out for, so you can be as efficient and get that cash flow. Today's video is brought to you by GameGlass. GameGlass allows you to take control of your ship from a tablet or phone. All the key bindings are neatly divided into well-designed shards, meaning you always have easy access to the exact features you need, regardless of what you're doing. On top of that, GameGlass also works with Elite Dangerous, so extend your cockpit and get the full immersive experience. Follow the link in the video description and try GameGlass for free. If you like it and want more shards and features, you can either buy them individually or subscribe to GlassPass. Use offer code DTEA and get 5% off your first purchase. Hello, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome back to Star Citizen with Down to Earth Astronomy. So we're going to talk about Quantinium mining, but before we begin to dive into all the different consumables and optional and passive modules, ships, lasers, where to go, what to do, all that stuff we're going to cover, I just want to give new players a very quick overview of how mining works so we get all the terminology correct when we're going to dive into the statistics of the equipment. So the very quick rundown of how mining works in Star Citizen is you find a good place to mine, you scan for rocks, you find a rock you want to mine, you scan that rock in detail. That gives you a little animation, as you can see here, where you have this charge level out at the side. Your job is to power on the laser, which you can control with your scroll wheel, and keep the power level, which is on the right side, in the green zone. Once the green zone is filled up, the rock will crack open, and you can then crack it down to smaller and smaller pieces until you can extract the materials you need. There is some main statistics around each rock that you need to be aware of. First of all, the mass. The heavier the rock is, the more power it requires to cut it open. Then there's the resistance. That kind of works with mass again, is how resistant it is to get rid of that, kind of the how quickly it dissipates the heat again. Instability. This depends on the materials inside. That depends how much that charge level is going to be fluctuating up and down. And then you have both the charge rate and the charge level. And for the purpose of the modules today, the charge rate refers to how quickly the red or green bar are filled up. So when you are in the window, the optimal window or the overcharge window, how quickly are those filled up? That is the charge rate. And the charge level is how quickly the bar fills up towards those windows, so how quickly it moves in between those levels. So keep those two figures in mind and know that those are separate stats. First of all, let's talk about ships. There are currently two mining ships available in Star Citizen. One of them is the Prospector, and the other one is the Mole. The Mole is more of a multi-purpose. It has bigger lasers. It has three separate lasers. The downside of the Mole, of course, is that you cannot control the mining laser from the helm seat. You have to go out and go down to the level below, where you can then get access to the laser from there. Whereas the Prospector is a solo miner. It has a single laser. It's slightly smaller than the ones you get at the Mole, but you can control it. Both the Prospector and the Mole you can get at the New Deal shipyard on Norwell. Prospector at 2 million Alpha UC and the Mole at 5.1 million Alpha UC. So you got yourself a ship, let's talk about the lasers. Now here we have the stats for the individual lasers, and you will probably start out when you buy the ship with the Abra MH1 laser. You can see here, mediocre power, no bonuses or drawbacks to the rock's instability, resistance, window size, that is the optimal window size, and no other buffs, but it is also dirt cheap. The only two I really think that is interesting to look at here is the Helix laser, Helix 1. Because of the high power output, you can see we get minus 30% to instability. That's good. So minus percent here are good, because minus to instability, we like that. And also minus to resistance, we like that too. And plus to the window size, that's nice too. So here you can see we get some really nice stats on the Helix. And also you notice that we get a buff to all charge rate. Remember, the charge rate is how quickly the windows fill up. These are both the optimal and the overcharge are getting a 20% bonus. So that's why it's both a buff and a debuff, because it is both windows here. The other one I find interesting is the Lancet MH1 laser. Now the power output of it here is really low, and this is actually described as a support laser, really designed to something you put on a mole and then use that laser to kind of stabilize the rock, and then you can use more powerful lasers to crack it open. But we can actually make this work on its own. The reason why this is interesting is because we are going to mine Quantinium, which is a highly unstable material. That means those fluctuations is going to be all over the place. So having that built-in minus 75% bonus to instability is crucial when it comes to continue mining. Also, it kind of like helps a little bit with the reduction to resistance from his low power output. So even though the power output is low, it has also a minus 75% to the rock's resistance, making it a little bit easier to work the laser on larger rocks. It's gonna take some time to fit it up. And the final thing that's also really good is when you're mining continuum, the optimal windows have a tendency to be really, really small. And that's why that 40% bonus to window size is also really, really good. The downside, of course, with the Lancet is it's not a quick laser, as you can see here. All charge rate is minus 30%. That's, of course, both a buff and a debuff. But that means we're gonna be spending more time in that green window in order to fill it up completely. Now, for the test today, I'll actually be running with the Lancet. And as I said, it has some drawbacks in terms of its power output and its charge rates. So we're gonna be trying to fix that in a second. And once you have your laser fitted on your ship, you will see that it has three sub-module slots. And these sub-module slots can take two different types of modules. It can either take consumable modules or passive modules. The passive modules are pseudo-permanent modules, I'll come back to that in a second, that just gives you a flat bonus. Let's start by looking at the passive modules. And we have the stats for all of them here. There are six different types of passive modules, and each of them comes in three different sizes. The bigger the size, the more buff, and the less debuff you get. So there's really no reason not to pick the largest one, other than the fact that they are significantly more expensive. And when I said they are semi-permanent, is while they will never expire or run out, as consumables will, if you lose your ship, your passive modules are gone. And as you can see here, for instance, if you're fitting a FLCR or a filter XL module, they cost 60,000 apiece. And if you have two of those fitted, that's 120,000 alpha UEC you just lost from losing those two modules. And you have to go out and find them again, and they may not be available the place you have to go. So it can become expensive. But nevertheless, let's talk about the different modules. We have, of course, the filter module, which filters out inert material. So whenever you're mining, there is this inert rock. We don't want it. It's basically garbage. And putting a filter in means you can reduce how much inert material you pick up. Of course, the drawback is you have a lower extraction rate, so it's going to take you a little bit longer. But extraction time's already so short, I haven't really found that debuff to be a huge issue. And that means if you dedicate two of your three passive slots, or module slots, to a XL filter, you're going to reduce your inert materials by 60%. They stack additively. So that's pretty cool, I think. Other than that, we have a focus that gives you up to a minus 10% reduction in resistance at the cost of 4% extra instability. Probably not something I would be using for continue mining, since we really don't want to have increased instability for that. You have a rigger, which gives you more window size at the cost of resistance. This would be good for continue mining if it wasn't, like if you didn't run with the Lancet. If you're running with a Helix, then you might want to fit Riga to get that bigger window. Then we have Deterrent, which is a 4% increase in power at the max, at a drawback of 3% extra instability. This, you would think this would be good, but I just think a 4% is just not enough. If it was a 10% or a 20% increase at the level 3, then it might have been worth it. But for a 4% increase in power output, I just don't think the turret is worth it. Then we have a Vaux, also coming in three different sizes, and the bigger one, of course, giving you a minus 10% to instability, and also minus 4% to window size. And finally, we have an extractor, or an XTR, also comes in three sizes, plus 50% to the extraction rate, and minus 2 to power. Again, if you really just want to speed things up, you're just going to go for speed mining something as quickly as possible. Go with a Helix and an extractor on it, so you can pull that rock out faster. Could also be an interesting option. For the build I'm going to be running today, I'm actually not going to be running any of the passive modules. I just want to go over them so you can pick and choose if there's any of them you like. The only one that I think could be worth it would be the filter, but I often find that I have enough room to mine a full rock even without the filters on, and as you will see, we're only going to be mining one rock at a time before we head back, and I'll come back to that when we get to the actual mining run. Next up, we have the eight different consumables we can fit in, and we're going to run through these really, really quickly. We can see all of them have a either bonus or drawback to heat generation and the signature size. This is how much heat your ship is generating and how easy it is to detect on scanners. The brand has a minus 50% bonus to charge rates. That means that the windows is going to fill up slower, But it comes with the buff of having -75% to instability. So this would be good on a Helix set to kind of get that instability under control. Then we have a Pharrell, -20% resistance and +20% instability. I really don't like the Pharrell because if you look at the wave bottom, we have the Torpede, which give you also -20% resistance, but instead of the +10% instability, you just have a -20% to charge rate, so you're gonna fill up the window slower. I feel like the Torpede is a much safer option than the Pharrell, since we then instead of getting the instability, we just have to spend a little bit more time there, and I much prefer that over the instability, because the instability can be really difficult to control. So of the two, I think the Torpede is the better option, and it's the first module I'll be running today. Next, we have the Lifeline. Your Lifeline is your emergency button. Things is going to go bad, your overcharge window is filling up, then you fire off your Lifeline. You can see the charge rate, how quickly those windows fill up, -90%. It's pretty much just going to stop. -90% to shatter damage. So this is really, this thing is going to blow. I'm going to try to stop it, and if I can't stop it, I'm going to take 90% of the shatter damage that it does when it explodes, and then pull that away. You can also see a very short duration of just 20 seconds. I should say, now that we're talking about the Lifeline, I want to jump down and talk about the Rhyme, because you can see here what that does is give you -50% to window level. So that's both the overcharge window and the optimum window. So this can also kind of work as an emergency button. You fire that off and it just drops those windows back really quick, so it buys you a little bit of time. It doesn't stop things and slow it down, give you time to adjust in the same manner as the Lifeline does. You can see the Rhyme is an instant, so you need to just use that as a, like, fire that off and then pull your throttle back so you don't end up overcharging. But you have too much power there already, then the Lifeline is a better option. I feel of the two, the ones I would prefer is probably the Lifeline. The Optimum just helps you expand that optimal window so you have a much, much bigger target to aim for at the cost of 10% extra instability. The two other modules I'll be running today is a Stampede, which increases my charge rate. That is how fast those windows fills up, both my optimal and the drawback, of course, being also the overcharge window. It increases that by 125%. That's massive. And that the cost, of course, is 10% extra instability, which I think is fair for how much time I can save by filling it up more than twice as fast. And the other one, the Surge, is it's a bit of a risky one to run the Surge, because what you can see it does is it increases the charge level. So that is the level up towards the windows, not the level inside the window. It increases that with a flat 40%. If you hit that overcharge window, it's going to fill up twice as fast. And if it explodes in your face, it's going to do triple the damage. So you need to be careful when using Surge. Don't use them. If you feel like the charge window is too low, then just take your time, fill it up normally. So now we've got all the equipment. Now it's time to talk about the locations where you want to mine. Now our base of operation is going to be in Kerr L1. We're going to be in Kerr L1 because inside Kerr L1 we have a station with a refinery deck. And that refinery deck, here we have the station, that refinery deck has a 3% bonus to continuum refining. So you're going to get 3% extra, something you don't get anywhere else in Stanton. So really this is the best place in the game to refine your continuum. Next, of course, we're going to find a mining spot. Now, since continuum is an unstable material, we need to get this back to the refinery as quickly as possible, because the longer time it spends in the ship, higher the chances it's going to explode. I believe you have 14, 15 minutes from when you mine the first fragment until your cargo hold is going to go critical and explode. Therefore, we're going to be mining in Her L3. I have some pretty good luck in Her L3, and as you can see, it is relatively close to Kerr L1, so not too much of a travel distance. Now we need to begin looking for some rocks. You can begin to first try to spot them manually, some of the rocks. What I like to do in terms of my speed, I want to put it like around here, so a little bit faster than usual. Then I hit C, you can see the little arrow there underneath your speed indicator. It kind of locks it in, so now the ship will just fly at that speed on its own. Then we're going to hit Tab to open up the scanner. Hold down right click, and I'm going to begin sending out pulses. These are the pulses that can very easily be detected by pirates, so be careful and keep an eye on your radar at the top center of the screen. And basically what we're going to be looking for is just keep scanning until we begin to find some big blue cubes. They'll show you one when they show up. Oh, there's one. So it took me about 4 minutes of flying around in here before the first one showed up. So you kind of need to look around until you get into a good area with lots of rocks around you. So you can see there, it kind of disappeared again, so we're just gonna fire off a new scan. And we're gonna just continue keeping that that cube in front of us and make our way towards it. Once we get within 2 kilometers, you can see the rocks will pop up, and they should get a little yellow outline. If they do not have the little white arrow underneath them, that means the rocks are bugged and they cannot be scanned. But in this case, I do have the little arrow, so these are good. I'm going to left click and hold down left click as I point at the rock, and the scan progress will start. We can see out here to the right now that this one does contain Quantinium. So we have 3 different rows here. We have first the name, this is Quantinium. Then we have the composite, so this is a 2.8% Quantinium rock, where the 2.8% is contained within 8.43% of the rock's volume. And it's only 2%, we want something more. We're looking for, I would say, anything around 20% or above is interesting. So right there, really lucky, we got a 32% Quantinium rock. So we're gonna move up and we're gonna hit M to start in our mining mode. It's gonna deploy our mining laser. And now we can go ahead and just point the rock and let the scan complete. And we can see now we have the we have our little bars. Now notice here out on the left hand side that on the top we have an efficiency range. You can see as I move away it says sufficient and it gets more and more yellow. And as I move closer, it goes from sufficient to optimal. And of course you need to keep an eye on your distance so you are within the optimal range. Below that we can see our mining modules, we can see our surge, torpor point, and our stampede. The optimal window is quite high, it's at least above 50%, I would say. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna crank this laser up to 100% using my scroll wheel. Then I'm gonna fire off a surge and you will see that charge level jump up real quick. Once it's done that, I'm gonna switch over to the torpede, which is going to increase the resistance, that's gonna help me hit the window. Another thing to keep an eye on is also as soon as I turn on the laser, look at this, how the optimal window increases. You see that? As soon as the laser turns on, the optimal window expands. And you can also see how the instability goes from 7.5 down to a 1.89. So we can see all those bonuses apply as soon as the laser hits the rock. So, but let's go ahead and let's do this. We're going to power up the laser. I'm going to hit Alt 1 for my search. There goes the search. Alt 2 for the tapoid. That is active now, and we should now begin to get our charge levels to increase as it begins to build up towards that charge window. Keep an eye on our optimal range, that is fine. There we go, we end the window. We're gonna swap over to the stampede. And look how quickly that optimal window fills up now. And in no time at all, we cracked that rock open, that was perfect. You can see they still have a yellow outline, that means they need to be refined further. We gotta scan each fragment. Notice this fragment here over on the right has no Quantinium in it, so we're not interested in that fragment. What about that one? 100% Quantinium in that. Perfect. Pure Quantinium. And we're gonna just scan all of them. We're gonna identify all the Quantinium rocks. Don't begin to break them up. 99.99% Quantinium. I'll take it, I'll call that pure as well. And we can see still, yellow outline means they need further refinement. Now the rocks are smaller, so you don't need all your fancy modules now. So you can just go ahead and just mine these normally without using your consumables, because a smaller rock, of course, means that even our relatively low power lancet head here can easily fill this up. Good, we have now cracked everything we need to crack, and we have identified all the fragments that contains Quantinium. So I'm going to right click to move this over to extraction mode, and then left click to start the extraction laser, and we're just going to begin to fill up. You can see over here on the right how we are now slowly filling up our cargo hold with lovely, lovely Quantinium. This one should be the last fragment. There we go. We got 27 SCU of Quantinium for that run. That is a very good haul. M to close down the mining laser, F2 to open up the map, and now we are on the race against time, so let's head back towards Curl 1, no time to waste. Now, in order to help you keep track of the time, there is actually up here in the corner, you can see here there's a little box here that says volatile cargo. There's a similar one in the mall. When that thing begins to light up yellow, that means you have 8 minutes left. When that thing goes orange, you have 4 minutes. Red, you have 2 minutes. 2 minutes basically means get out the seat and run, because if you're in the ship, you're going to be dead in 2 minutes. Once you arrive in KL1, you can immediately charge up your frameshift drive again, because you can actually make another little micro quantum hop towards the station, just to put you a little bit closer so you don't have to fly as fast. It's gonna save you some time. And again, as we talked about, time is critical right now. And we are on the path, but we are not safe yet. That timer is still running, so not just because you're out of your ship doesn't mean that it's not gonna explode on you, and we still need to go and sell this cargo. Well, not sell it, but put it into the refinery. As soon as you arrive in the lobby, head over to the little terminals here and store your mining ship, because as soon as your ship is stored, it is safe. So here we have my prospector. I'm gonna click store and wait a little bit for it to go into storage. There we go, once it says receive here, it is now in storage, and now it's safe. The ship cannot explode while it's in storage. From the little area, the security area, or the lobby when you arrive, we're gonna run towards the little burrito bar, make a left, then a right down the corridor. Before the easy hubs, you're gonna find the elevators over here, right next to the easy hub, and calling one of those, we can make our way down to the refinery. Once you go out of the elevators in the refinery, make it across the refinery hall. There's a store here on the ground floor, by the way, so if you need any mining equipment, consumables, mining heads, this is a good place to pick it up. There are similar shops at some of the other L1s where you can pick up similar items, so that's a good place. But we're gonna head upstairs, and we could sell the continuum just directly to the refinery as the raw materials, and we'll get around, I think it's about 40 alpha UC per ton, but we want more. So we're going to refine it to a more refined material. We're going to do that here at the refinery terminals. You can see I already have some jobs. We're going to come back to those in a second. But you're going to go over here. We're going to select our prospector. And we're going to say setup work order. For method, I recommend the Dingsy here. Dingsy's solventens, whatever. It gives the highest yield, and it's a super cheap method. The downside is it takes forever, as you will see here. I'm gonna say I want to refine my continuum and say get quote. So you can see it's gonna take 1 day, 16 hours. It's only gonna cost me 6,000 alpha UC, but I'm almost gonna get the full yield out of it. This is one of the best yields you get for the lowest price. You pay for having it being a very slow process. Work order accepted. And if we scroll out here, you can now see the order running and you can see how much time there's left. But I've of course come prepared. As you can see, I actually have four orders here that are already completed with some varying degrees of quantanium in them. I should say this refined quantanium, you can sell that for 88. So that's more than twice what you can with the unrefined. So this is definitely, definitely worth it. But in order to sell this, we need to put it into a transport ship. Remember we said at the beginning, we need a transport ship on site here. I have a Freelancer Max sitting here, so I'm gonna go down when the work order is completed. Gotta select my Freelancer Max, and I'm gonna click collect. Took the cargo entrance because you can see there's a few boxes on display in here because we have cargo on board. Now, don't worry, the cargo is not volatile after it's been refined, so there's no chance of this blowing up. However, there is still the risk that because this is cargo, if you 30k, if you lose your ship now, well, it's gone. And that was like a couple of days worth of mining. So I really don't want to lose this right now. In order to sell, I like to go to Arc Corp and go to Area 18. I found that to be the best place to sell. So that's where I'll be going. After arriving, make your way to the main plaza, easily identified by this cogwheel spinny thing at the center. And then we're looking for the trade division, which you can find over here. TDD, it says, with big bold letters on top of the building, on over the door, so very easy to spot. And then any of these terminals here along the big display walls. Here we're gonna go to sell. We're gonna sell from our freelancer. We can see we have a few other materials on board, but we just mainly want to sell our quantinium. And you can see here we're gonna get 87.8 AUC per unit, and that means this hole here is going to give me 850,000 alpha UC. So sell quantinium and give it time to process. Once we click got it, we just got ourselves almost a million, and there we have it. We just made ourselves a very pretty penny. Now If you haven't picked up Star Citizen already and you are interested in it, I have a referral code. You can see it here on screen. If you use that or you go to getstarcitizen.d2ea.com, you get some extra starting credits, so there's a little bit less mining for you there, and you help me out. I'm not going to get paid for it, but I get some extra ships and fancy stuff in game. If you did enjoy this video, I would really appreciate if you would go down and subscribe to the channel for more Star Citizen content in the future, and also give this video a like so you know that you want more stuff like this. That's it for this time, thanks a lot for watching, and until next time, I will see you guys in space.